On the agenda is Payne and Relocation Consultants Management Group Parking Lot Rezoning and General Plan Amendment.
And Buzz, I need to recuse myself because of my proximity of my home to this.
We will be hearing from you, though.
Okay, so a little bit of a background in on this topic as well. In November of 2008, the council approved a 166-unit residential mixed-use project known as Parkside Residential Project, and it was also known as the Paper Mill Project. The project included construction of a public park and a replacement of parking lot for 41 private parking spaces, which were owned by the owners of building across the street at 1335 Stanford Avenue. In February of 2012, the council approved the design for the park and the parking lot upon the recommendation of the Planning Commission. So this was the parcel configuration for the park area and the parking lot area. So these two private pieces of property were owned by PRC, which also owned the brick building across the street. And these spaces provided parking for the PRC building. And this was the parking, the park and the parking lot configuration that was approved by the council upon your recommendation, and is the whole project is under construction as we speak. And so as a result of that park, this is the draft parcel map that would revise the parcel configuration. So you have the parking lot parcel that goes, surrounds the parcel, the parking lot parcel. So when the general plan was adopted in 2009, all the parcels of the park and the parking lot had the following designations. So the land use diagram for both the park and the parking lot was MUR, and the FAR was 1.2, and the maximum building height was 30, which could be increased to 55 with a bonus. And the density, as far as the maximum density map was concerned, there was no designation for the park or the parking lot. Subsequently, the planning regulations were adopted in February of 2013, and the zoning map designated these parcels as open PO or park/open space. As part of the negotiations of the land swap between the city and the PRC, the PRC requested that their new parking lot parcel be rezoned from PO to MUR, and that the maximum residential density map, which currently shows a blank or no designation, that a designation of 50 units per acre be added. And this would be consistent with the density of the Parkside project to the north. Also, as part of this, the city-owned park parcel would also be redesignated from MUR to park/open space on the general plan use designation. So this is the revised general plan land use diagram, and I'm going to zero in to the parcels of concern. So this is the existing. Now, this is an error. These are not green. It should be shaded red or orange. So this entire, all the parcels would be MUR. And what we are proposing today is to revise that to make the park area green or PO and the parking lot MUR, which is what the park site designation is. Similarly, as part of this proposal, the maximum residential density map would also be revised. And to zero in again, the existing map shows, as I mentioned, no designation, so it's white or blank. And with this proposal, the parking lot parcel would be made consistent with the park site, and that is 50. The third map that would be revised as part of this proposal is the zoning map in the planning regulations. And the current zoning map designates the entire park and the parking lot as open space. And after this proposal, the park area would remain as PO and the parking lot would be designated as MUR. So in order to approve a general plan amendment, the commission must make a recommendation to the council outlining its reasons for its for the recommendations, its consistency with the general plan guiding principles, its internal consistency with the general plan, as well as consistency with any other adopted plans. So when the general plan was being developed, the park site project, including the public park, had not yet been approved. Therefore, the general land use diagram designates the entire block as MUR. A potential new park on this block is indicated by a green circle on the land use diagram. And although it is not a part of the report, we are indicating that this green circle on the land use diagram be removed, as we now have a park that is under construction. And therefore, this green circle of a potential park on this block is no longer needed. The Planning Commission also must make the following findings for the rezoning of the parcels. And these are the four findings that the commission must make. And staff believes these findings can be made because the amendment to redesignate the PRC parking lot from PO to MUR is consistent with the general plan. And the parking lot meets the parking requirements of the PRC office located across the street at 1335 Stanford Avenue. And therefore, a more appropriate designation is MUR that allows the office to use by right and is also the land use designation of the surrounding properties. It may be noted that there is a 20-foot wide public utility easement that runs east to west throughout this block. This is just as an FYI in terms of it does, because it has implications for future development of this block. So with that, the staff recommends that the commission recommend that the city council approve the general plan amendment and the rezoning as described in the report that is in front of you. You would have received a email from Commissioner Gunkel, and this email or letter was written as a citizen, as he needs to be recused for this item. And I believe he also has a PowerPoint presentation for you today. So if you have any questions at this time, I would be happy to answer.
I have a question. Can you explain what the PUE would prohibit or what kind of implications would occur because it is running through the center of that property?
If there is ever a proposal on this MUR, the parking lot parcel, then they would need to relocate the East Bay Mud's underground pipe. So that would have immense cost implications. That is the main, it would have a lot. They would have to relocate that easement and that pipe and the infrastructure beneath it.
And in addition, so there are two pipes. One is a storm drain and one is a water main. The water main is East Bay Mud's, but the city has a storm drain running through there too. So the city has an easement right to have its storm drain located in the area that that Maru is describing. So in order for any development to occur over this portion, you would need to have both the storm drain and the water main to be relocated. And so you would need to have the cooperation from both East Bay Mud and the city.
Could the project be built to where they could still have access to those, say maybe a parking structure to where if they needed access to those lines, they could do that and not have to relocate them?
It depends on what the project would be.
Right. So mean, it doesn't predicate that it has to be moved. They can work around that?
Again, potentially? It depends on what the project is, but these are major infrastructure components, certainly from the city's perspective, and I'm sure East Bay Mud would say something similar. So the city is not going to be this isn't something that the city would undertake lightly to relocate its facilities. I'm sure East Bay Mud would say something similar in regards to its storm drain or water mains.
Part of the issue is not only just damage to the pipes, but also future access to them if they need to be dug up and, you know, maintained for any reason. So you could potentially build a building over it with footings on either side of the pipes and kind of bridge across it. But let's say the building was a small residential building and it had parking on the ground floor in a garage with a podium over it or something like that, which is the most likely scenario. You'd still have to be able to get into that garage and dig down into the ground to get at the pipes, which would displace the parking in the garage for a period of time, and there may not be enough headroom in the garage even to do that. So it'd be very tricky to design a building over those pipes. If I may just add something also, the doctors who are going to be the owners of this parking lot don't have any intention to build anything on it. Their issue is just that when they got their conditional use permit for their office across the street in 2010, they had, as they still have, because we're still working on the land swap, two parcels across the street in our city parking lot that accommodates about 40 parking spaces. At that time, we were operating under the new general plan, but the interim zoning regulations. And the interim zoning regulations, as you may recall, used the general plan land use map as the zoning map. And as Mira explained, the general plan land use map showed these parcels as mixed use with retail at the time. And subsequently, they were rezoned to open space. And the new parking lot would also be rezoned as open space. The doctors feel that it was kind of unfair that their property was rezoned from mixed use with residential to open space. And they, if as a part of the deal for this land swap to get the new parking lot, they just want it rezoned back to what it used to be. But they don't have any intention to build anything. So that's,
is the swap signed or is it still
being? Oh, no, this is a condition of the swap. If this is not approved, they probably will not agree to the swap, which means the city will then not, or the Parkside Apartment developers won't be able to build the park that's proposed.
So did that, it's not really a rezoning, I mean, it's, well, kind of. So when the planning regulations were adopted with the corresponding zoning map, did that make that area out of compliance with the general plan, or parks are allowed in that whatever the general plan designation is? I already forgot.
Mixed use.
The general plan designation was mixed use with residential. The general plan map had a green circle, still has a green circle, on this block, which indicated a park opportunity. At that time, when the general plan was adopted, we didn't know exactly where the park would be or how it would be designed. And so that green circle was like a placeholder for some future park on the block. By the time the new zoning regulations or planning regulations were adopted, we had the park designed, so we just designated that parcel as open space. They're not inconsistent. It's just that the general plan is general, right? Zoning is more specific. So the general plan, I mean, the zoning takes that green circle on the general plan map and makes it a specific parcel.
Okay.
Oh, by the way, that reminds me, there's an amendment to our staff recommendation. Did you mention this already? That we want to take the green circle off the map.
Okay.
Just
so we, so maybe then that rezoning in the planning regulations was just maybe a little overeager in that the park was designed, but it, you know, the parking lot was still, the private parking lot was still there. So.
Right. Right.
Okay, I have a question for you, Maru, and then also a couple of statements of concern. It talks about the FAR for that being 1.6 or 1.2 to 1.6. If a project was to be built within those guidelines, how big a building could be put on that parcel using that FAR? Are we talking a three-story building, a four-story building?
Well, the height
is limited to 30 or 55.
Yeah, it's 30 to 55. So,
right, but what does, will the FAR allow something that tall?
Yeah, it could be. potentially. I mean, whether it would be approved or not, it can be proposed.
Right.
But, you know, given the parking, given the requirements, given the landscaping, open space.
Right. Well, the thing that concerns me is the language in the statement here, so that to be able to build by right, that, you know, I know that's a common term, but that was specifically mentioned in here. And then the fact that we do have a designation of lower height than what is being proposed, why are we not going for that if we're not intending to do something else there?
We are trying to make it consistent with the surrounding, which is MUR, which is on the top and also on the east.
Right.
So that's...
The FAR and the height limit are already in place, even on the open space zoning. So we're just not proposing to change that.
Okay. And what I was wondering is there's the base with the bonus that's 2035, and that's what the parcels across the street are. So it's not out of the neighborhood or out of the realm of the area to go that low.
2035? Really kind of, no, 3055.
Yeah, the 2035 is the units per acre that you're talking about, the residential density.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Density.
Yeah. Exactly. So but this is asking for 5060, which Parkside is, but across Doyle Street, the lots are 2035. So if we're not worried about building something there, why aren't we going for the lowest level that is in the area or that we can possibly go for?
Yeah, I had the same question.
I think the staff's idea was to make it consistent with the MUR and the Parkside above. Mm-hmm. Whether can we make it lower? I see no reason why not.
I had another question. So Commissioner Keller brought up the question I had earlier. I just lost my train of thought. Okay, we got to come back to it. I just got derailed.
I have a question in the meantime. Maru, do you know the history of how the city came to own a parcel that completely surrounds two private parcels in what I assume is a former railroad right-of-way?
I don't. I believe Charlie is.
I have a, sort of. I wasn't here then. The guy you really need to hear from is Maurice Kaufman. Unfortunately, he's not here tonight. Stanford Avenue is very wide, was very wide. If you go to the other side of San Pablo, you know it's really wide with that big median. That same width extended all the way through Emeryville, all the way down to the mainline railroad tracks. It used to be an interurban streetcar train line that went from San Francisco to downtown Berkeley. When that rail line was abandoned, whoever owned the property that is now the PRC Clinic took the opportunity to talk to the railroad and I think bought some property that the railroad used to own so that they could park on it. And then subsequently the city came along and eyed it as a public parking lot. So the city decided to buy the property as a parking lot, but there were already private parking spaces there, so we had to build our parking lot around the private parking spaces. And I think there might have been some reconfiguration of the parcels at that time to result in the parcel configuration that you have today. But basically, they were there first. And then the city came along and got our parking lot. Mm-hmm. So this private parking has been there for a long time.
Is the square footage of the parcel that they will own in the future equal to the total of the two of the existing parcels they own?
It wasn't intended to be an equal square foot for square foot swap. It's roughly equal, I think. But the more key thing was the number of parking spaces. So they'll end up with approximately the same number of parking spaces that they have now. And it was just designed to make it work.
It's 0.21. For the doctors and 0.77 for the city. Right. It's not equal. I remembered my questions. One of them was going back to your concern about having the by right language in there. So I just wanted to clarify it because what I'm reading on page 4 of the staff report, the very bottom, is that it's the very last sentence. It says the parking lot meets the parking requirements of the PRC office located across the street, and therefore a more appropriate designation is mixed use with residential that allows office use by right and is also the land use designation of the surrounding properties. So it's office use by right, but the concern was more about building a residential building. Was that your concern, or was it just being able to build a taller building
overall, any concern I would have would build a building in that space that would be within 20 feet maybe of an existing building.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, everyone knows I'm for height than density, but there's a limit.
Yeah.
And I think that crosses that threshold. I just think that anything built there above a story or two would just impact the neighborhood in a way that I don't think would foster good feelings towards other developments of that type. It's just, if that's the intent, I don't know.
Okay, so that really wasn't a question. It was more of kind of a discussion point. Do we have any other areas in the city where we have like a land use within a land use like this one, or is this going to be the first kind of that type?
You mean an island that's surrounded by other designations?
Yeah, it just struck me. It just stood out.
I can't think of any.
I mean, the whole idea was to clean such things up with the new general plan and mm-hmm. the zoning map.
And the other
to have that, so
yeah. The other question I had is the parking lot private at all times, or is it open to the public on the weekends or in the evenings?
It is private at all times. Okay. It will not be open to public at any time.
Okay.
The same.
It is private property.
The existing parking spaces are also private at all times. Not to say that other people don't park there, but they're not supposed to.
Right, right. Or it could be chained off on, I don't know. Okay, that's all the questions I have.
So then, is the commission ready to hear from the public?
Does the applicant wish to speak?
We're actually not the applicant.
The city actually is the applicant for this, but these are the potential property owners.
Property owners, excuse me.
I'm Ray Buddy. I'm an attorney with Alan Atkins for the
property. Speak into the microphone, please.
Sure.
Thank you.
Ray Buddy, attorney for the property owners. We have the cooperation of the city. We've been working with the city to get the whole land swap done so the park can properly get built. And in the process, when this happened in 2013 and you adopted your new general plan, the map came into play and I think unintentionally changed or potentially changed the zoning. So we just worked with staff to try to get things back to consistency with the surrounding area. There are a number of other things that are going to happen as part of this land swap. There is no easement across the property right now, but there are the pipes that have been referred to that are across the property. There's no official easement, but as part of the land swap, there will be an easement put in place in favor of the city of Emeryville. So where the storm drain is, and I believe I'm correct on that, right? There's no easement. There's no official easement there now.
Okay.
But there will be as part of the land swap. So the property will be burdened with an easement going forward. What that may mean for future development, if any, I don't know. It's a parking lot right now. But the property owners certainly did not want to be in the position where their parking, which was necessary for a property across the street, was now on your open space, something that was zoned for open space adjacent to a park that wouldn't allow this kind of a use potentially. So we're just trying to get it for a consistent use. It is used for the parking right now, consistent zoning. It's used for the parking. It'll have the easement across it. Using that property for parking is a condition of the approval for the existing building, the PRC building across the street, which I think staff can verify for you. So it's really just a cleanup issue, and it makes sense for the property owners to have it zoned in a way that allows them to have this use there. If somebody in the future owned the property and tried to do some kind of development, it would be subject to whatever rules were in place at that point in time. But there are no plans in any fashion to develop this property. Okay, so thank you. I can answer any questions that you might have.
Can you describe the easement a little bit more fully that's being negotiated?
So right now, there are two pipes that run through the property. There's no easement officially, but there are two pipes. One is an East Bay Mud water line, and the other is City of Emeryville, I believe, your storm sewer line. As part of the land swap, we're actually going to delineate an easement across the property, and it's going to be on the parcel map. The easement is going to be shown. I think it's
is it 26 feet wide? Or
give or take.
So that's, so it's actually going to go the length of the property and run through your park as well, I guess. But it's actually going to be delineated and shown on the parcel map that'll be recorded as part of the land swap.
So that would preclude structures being built over that 26-foot swath?
Would it? Highly unlikely that someone could build over that. That's just my...
It's actually 20 feet.
20 feet, okay. So it's a 20-foot swath that kind of runs through the center of the entire thing. So
through the middle?
Not quite through the middle, but close.
It's on the. It's on page... Sure.
Mr. Gina has a copy of the proposed parcel map.
Oh, you printed out.
Yeah. Oh, it's not on any page. It's the one I printed out.
Oh.
There you go.
There's the incorrect one. It's attachment three. So
it's slightly more towards the interior of the block than it is towards Stamford.
More towards the north.
So it's 20 feet wide, and the dash lines are showing where that would be. And as you see, it runs the length east-west of the parcel. And so it'll be under both the city park here in parcel A, and then the doctor's parking lot here in parcel B.
One is sewer and one is water?
They're both within the same easement.
They're both in the same easement.
Right. They'll both be in that 20-foot wide strip, and one is storm drain and one is a water main.
Right. And as I said, right now, there, while the lines are there, there is no easement, but there will be as part of the parcel map that gets recorded as part of the land swap going forward.
That's leaving 27 and a half feet south of the easement.
Well, furthermore, you'd have to stand back a little bit from the easement, too, probably.
Thank you.
I have one more question for staff if we're done with the...
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Owners, thank you. On this exhibit, the parcel B that's shown is a slightly different shape than the parking lot that's shown. I realize it's just sort of a conceptual drawing, but the... in attachment to the park design... What accounts for the more rectangular shape in the
That's a very preliminary drawing that's shown in attachment 2. It's actually been fleshed out in more detail than that now, but if you look at the drawing in attachment 2, you can see how there's a kind of a hammerhead at the west end of the parking lot, and then there's green space around that.
Uh-huh.
Those green squares at the end will be part of the doctor's parcel, and those will actually be stormwater treatment areas to treat the stormwater that comes off the parking lot surface.
Ah, okay.
So it all gets fitted into this rectangle.
Okay. So it's a little bit of function of not wanting drainage to cross property lines and that kind of thing.
Well, right, and every property is supposed to treat their own stormwater.
Yeah.
So it was designed, it was sized to meet the stormwater treatment requirements of this parking lot. And the strip on the south side, of course, is part of the city sidewalk and landscaping and street trees and everything along Stamford Avenue. And the strip on the north side is also city, and that's where the path is that goes from Doyle Street over to the park and provides access into some of the units, ground floor units on the paper or the Parkside project.
I have a question. What could the city do, for instance, if we wanted to make sure that the property owners had the right to have this parking lot in perpetuity? Is there a way to include that in this and continue to keep it as open space, or to keep this ground level parking lot?
Well, they do have a right to keep it in perpetuity. Are you saying that you want to impose a condition that it can only be a parking lot in perpetuity?
That's not, no. It wasn't quite what I was getting at. I guess if it was rezoned as open space, then...
It already is zoned as open space. They want it rezoned to not be open space.
Gotcha.
Okay, never mind.
Any further questions of staff? Open the meeting to the public. Brad, did you want to speak?
He got his PowerPoint queued up?
Yeah.
Commissioners, thank you. So the general plan indicates a park opportunity for this site with zero residential density. And the main selling points of the Parkside project included the continuity of the open space from the Stanford Park all the way through to Hollis, as well as the preservation of the brick facade of the existing building along Stanford. The zoning, and the zoning reflects the intentions of the general plan and the promise of the Parkside project to establish that open space. The replacement of the open space with a new building, a new apartment building, sorry, this is moving around, would hide the brick facade that everyone went out of their way to preserve, as well as block sunlight into one of the two primary courtyards of the Parkside project. Doyle Street is currently, as it will remain, a pedestrian and bicycle-oriented street, which feeds into a very active park, the Stanford Park. Hollis is primarily a vehicular corridor, and isolated parks on Hollis that don't have access to other streets are seldom, if ever, used. The parking lot of the pain clinic is almost always at capacity. Walked by there three different times over this week, and at all times had 41, at least 41 cars in it. And all of the streets in the vicinity of this site are at capacity during the week, and some of the streets are at capacity during weekends. I believe that the current proposal eliminates continuity of open space. It creates an isolated, little utilized park on Hollis. It'll cast a large shadow during the hours of peak use on a currently sunny and active park. It'll hide carefully preserved brick facade at Parkside, block sun from the Parkside courtyard, and add to the demands of the street parking that's already at capacity. The park plan that we brought, that we all bought into, gave the pain clinic a parking lot, not a right to build an apartment building on top of it. If this is intended to be an open space, then it should stay zoned open space. If this becomes mixed-use residential, it will be built on. And I've definitely done projects over easements, and I've definitely moved public pipes, city pipes, for projects. So those will happen. This will get built. And I just want to ask you to please reject this proposal. Thank you.
Any further speakers?
Hi.
Please sign in afterwards, too.
Afterwards?
Yeah.
My name is Adrian McGilley.
Speak into the,
I basically would second everything that Commissioner Gunkel just said. We watched carefully the decision making around the Parkside development and that whole zone, and we value the notion of continuity of open space and not doing anything that would be detrimental to the park. So I'm not going to repeat all of his points. I think he has summed it up very well. And we have a letter here signed by about 10 people, and I'll just read that. We are firmly opposed to this rezoning request. That strip of land along Stanford was designed to maintain an open space extending from Stanford Park all the way to Hollis. If you put a building there, it will defeat that design goal. It will cast shadows on Stanford Park. We are also concerned that it will eat up parking spaces that are currently used by the clinic, thus causing more of the clinic's patients and employees to use street parking, which is already overflowing along Stanford and Doyle Streets. Under the current design, mature trees will be destroyed in order to make room for the pain clinic's parking needs. That initially was a hard pill to swallow, but we swallowed it. It is now impossible to understand how anyone could turn around and claim that there is room to put a building there on this small sliver of land, which essentially would destroy the fragile density of our neighborhood. If there's room for a building, then there's certainly room for the trees. The city should reject this request. Thank you.
Any further speakers on this matter?
Hi, Judy Timmel, and I also live about a block from this project at 5514 Doyle. When I attended meetings about the project, Parkside project, this was sold to the community as residential with this open space buffer in between our neighborhood and it. As you can see now, it is a huge, hulking building, and I don't know how it got approved at so much higher than all the surrounding buildings, and I even went to the meetings. Adding more density to this is just ludicrous, and as Brad said, if it's allowed, it will be built, or it can be built. There must be a way to preserve the park and the open space and the parking lot without approving the possibility of another building on this site. We have no idea what the impact of all these cars will be on our neighborhood yet. They haven't moved in. We think it will be large. There's an entrance to a parking lot right on Doyle Street. Doyle Street is very narrow. It's a bicycle pedestrian way, and it cannot accommodate anymore. It was shown that you needed to show that there was consistency with the general plan. I think that it definitely does not meet that requirement. Number two, that it was have benefit to the public, and this is definitely not going to be a beneficial to the public in any way. It cuts off our park from another park and creates way more density in our neighborhood. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Linda Henderson. I also live on Doyle Street at 5514 Doyle. I've been a resident of Emeryville for 11 years. I'm going to focus for just a moment on what I've heard this evening. I've heard that there is no intention to build on the parking lot by the part of the doctors. I've heard that it's just a matter of a cleanup issue. I've heard that it's for consistency's sake. Well, I'll tell you what that sounds like to me, bureaucraties. I don't believe that there is any way that with the current height limitation that's attached to this proposal, there won't be a possibility of a building being built on that parking lot at some point in the future. I hear to build by right. I understand that to mean that the doctors can build by right at some point, or whoever owns that particular parcel. I don't mean to insult anybody on this commission in any way, shape, or form, or any of the people who've done the work on this project. I just mean to highlight what I think is really a tenuous, uncertain situation that can affect everybody in a very, very small, dense, pocketed neighborhood. I live there, I walk the streets, I walk my dog, I drive my car. It's already impossible to try to get through the traffic on Doyle and Stanford. So I would urge you, commissioners, please, please, at the very least, consider proposing to lower that height limitation that was mentioned in your conversation earlier this evening, which this woman, Ms. Desai, said that there shouldn't be a problem doing. And I think if you do that, you'll go a long way toward ensuring that there won't be any kind of detrimental future impact to that very, very fragile area of Emeryville. And for those of all of us here who live in Emeryville, we know how fragile that can be. So thank you very much for hearing my thoughts this evening. I appreciate your time.
I'm the administrator at Pain and Rehab, and I'm here to represent the doctors. We definitely want to be good neighbors. We understand the parking and the traffic situation. We actually have a hard time with that as well. Right now, all of that traffic is because of the construction workers parking on the street. We constantly are trying to get them to stay out of our parking lot, and we can't even park on the street because of that. So I know they have a lot of parking with the new development, like over 400 spaces. So when we purchased the property, we had those two landlocked parcels, and we worked with the city. Whatever they needed, first week they had a plan to have our parking lot on the west side, I believe. But and then I think first it was along the whole side of Stanford, and then the west side, and then it got shifted over to the east side, and I'm not quite sure why that happened, but. I mean, if they want the continuity of the open space, then maybe we should put our parking lot back on the Hollis side and, you know, have the designation back as multiple use. We just feel it was brought into the open space by accident, and we would like it to put back to the original. It doesn't have to be 4 or 5 stories high. It can be back to the original that it was, the 30/55 feet. I don't think that the doctors would have a problem with that.
Again, Raymond Buddy representing the doctors, the property owners. So several things to bear in mind. One, there's a proposed land swap in order to accommodate the planned park as well as the parking lot, but the parameters of what that swap could look like are not defined. The current geographic or geometric layout of the park and the parking lot is what the parties have collectively worked with to try to come up with, but that doesn't have to be the way that it is. So there's any number of different permutations in which the parking could be there and a park could be there, but this is what they've come up with. The zoning, you can't spot zone, so you can't create a brand new zone simply for this parcel of land that doesn't match any of the surrounding properties. So you can't just create a new zone that has its own density and setbacks and height limitations and things of that nature. So it does need to be consistent with the surrounding. So that's why we've gone with the MUR zoning as consistent for this particular parcel. In terms of whether somebody ever tries to come forward with a proposal, it'll be subject to whatever the rules are and whatever the issues are at that point in time. And I'm sure you'd hear from people who supported it or didn't like it at that point in time. So we have what's there right now. It makes sense. A lot of work has gone into it. If it can't get rezoned, then this proposal, this land swap in the park's not going to go forward the way it is right now. So I don't know where that leaves things, but that's where things are right now. Okay, so thank you.
Any further comment from the public?
Hi, my name is Sarah Hendlish. I also live at 5514 Doyle Street. And I just moved to the neighborhood a month ago on April 15th with my husband and our young child, age 5. And part of the appeal of moving to this neighborhood was the park and that it felt like a family-friendly neighborhood. And I just strongly request that in your consideration of this matter that you would please try to do your best to preserve the family-friendly character of the neighborhood. Thank you.
Any further? Well, you've made your comment. Any further comment? Close the public meeting. Curry, do you want to start?
I don't want to start this time.
I have one question for staff. How did How did this entire Parkside project get approval without this issue being resolved? It strikes me as rather odd that the ownership wasn't established at the time the permits for the building were issued, because this park was a condition of the project.
Well, it was a, it just, it hadn't been sorted out yet. I mean, I'm remembering the sequence of events. Parkside was approved in 2008, is that right? And the PRC clinic, at that time, the paper mill, as it was then called, project was required to build a park. The idea was that there would be a land swap, but that required the cooperation of the people across the street, and we didn't want to hold up the approval of the paper mill project for that. When the PRC project came for their conditional use permit in 2010, a condition of approval of that use permit was that they would cooperate with the city on such a land swap, and they have. So, you know, it's just a matter of sequencing.
Worst case condition that the city council does not approve this zoning change, and the they keep the two existing parcels as is. What effect does that have on the approval of the development as a whole?
The approval of the paper mill development?
Yeah.
Well, there's not much they can do in terms of building a park if the two existing parking parcels remain where they are.
But they gave them the approval of the building under the condition that the park would be there.
Well, it's not their fault. They wouldn't be in default of their conditions if they didn't build a park, if they weren't physically able to. I think, but you know, the Planning Commission and City Council have both approved the park design also, with the assumption that this land swap would happen. If it didn't, then, I mean, I guess what would happen is a park could be redesigned. It would have to be redesigned around those parcels, and that would have to come back to the Commission and Council for approval.
Right. The park would not be able to be built in the current configuration in that case. If the existing, if the doctor's existing parking configuration were to remain, you'd essentially have city park parcels surrounding two private parking lots. And while the applicant or the Parkside project would still be obligated to build a park, the configuration would be less desirable because it would have to be essentially a donut type of park with the two private parking lots in the middle, instead of one continuous park, which is what you know, staff, and which is what the City Council had approved essentially in the
So what would the zoning be on these two parking lot parcels?
Well, if we didn't, if the zoning were not changed, it's currently open space. The general plan designation is mixed use with residential, with a green circle.
Still be in conflict.
So they'd be mixed use parcels.
Under the general plan.
Under the general plan of a dimension that's not of much use for construction.
Right. I would just note that the issue about the land swap, conditioning a project on a future land swap is not unprecedented. Mm-hmm. We had a similar situation with the small small triangular building at, I think it's 5701 Hollis. It's right across the street. It's a corner of Hollis and Stanford, northwest corner. So in that case, they owned basically half of the Greenway strip there. And we swapped them the city, what used to be a city parking lot on Stanford Avenue, for the Greenway strip so we could have a wider Greenway. when they got the conditional use permit to for the use in that building, that land swap was a condition of that use permit, but it took a couple of years then to effectuate the land swap because it takes a lot of, you know, it takes surveying and it takes creating all these legal documents and all these negotiations, and you know, you don't want to hold up the entitlements while all of that stuff is going on.
Can the staff give us a little, I know it was a long process, but can you give us a little bit of history on the park design? I'm specifically curious about the how the layout of the park was chosen that put the parking lot on that side.
This dates back about 6 years. The initial idea that was floated by staff that the city council looked at was to have the parking on for the doctors on the north side of Stanford, just on the street, and it would either be 90-degree parking or angle parking. There were a number of problems with that. One was that it was private parking, but and you could put signs up, but it would look like public parking, and it would be very difficult to police it, very difficult to keep the public from parking there. Also, because that's a bicycle boulevard, it wasn't really considered desirable to have angle parking or 90-degree parking where cars are constantly backing out into, you know, the path of bicyclists. That would have provided the largest park configuration because then the whole rest of the block from there to the building could have been park. But there were all kinds of problems with, you know, just how it didn't work. So it was decided that that wasn't such a great idea. And then, as I recall, there were two or three different concepts for how a separate parking lot could be configured. One could be at the west end along Hollis Street, one could be the east end where we finally ended up, there could be one in the middle. A lot of different iterations were looked at, and frankly I can't remember everything or all the process that we went through, but ultimately was decided to put it where it ended up, partly because the Parkside project includes a restaurant, hopefully, at the Hollis Street end, and the park design includes a plaza or a little outdoor area that would be immediately adjacent to that restaurant.
Okay.
So it seemed more desirable to have that than to have a parking lot right next to the restaurant. Also, the Parkside project is not exactly symmetrical, and I believe that the little open space gap that's between the two buildings where they're going to have a swimming pool, some other things. By the way, one of the conditions of approval of the project is that there be 24/7 public access through the middle of the Parkside project, so you'll be able to walk mid-block through the project between Powell and Stanford. And if the parking lot were put at the Hollis Street end, I believe that the tail end of the parking lot would have overlapped that central access, so that pedestrians walking through the project would have had to, you know, would have been faced with a parking lot when they got to the south side. Whereas there's enough room if you put it at the Doyle Street end that you don't have that situation. People walking through the project will be walking into the park instead of into a parking lot. There were a lot of different factors that went into it.
Okay.
This is what we ended up with.
Okay. Thank you.
And I would note there were two community meetings on the design of the park as well.
I have a couple questions. The parking concerns that are brought up, if this parcel was ever to be developed, is it not understood that it has to park itself, whatever they build there? Plus, they would still have to accommodate the 41 spaces for the doctor's office, right?
Oh, of course.
Yeah, so building a building there is not going to cause additional parking problems on the street, although it always does. But that's just something I wanted to make clear, that you know, any building built there has to park itself. Is it our purview in doing this that we can change the resolution and the conditions on this? Can we, I know that the by right thing is a language that's pretty much textbook or something, but is that something we can eliminate so that anything that does get planned there, it has to come to the Planning Commission, that it can't just be approved administratively?
Well, it wouldn't be approved administratively anyway, because every new construction project requires design review, which is discretionary. So even if the use and the height and the FAR and the residential density were all by right, it would still require discretionary design review approval. And new construction has to go to the Planning Commission.
But we'd just be judging it on design, whether we like the design or not, not whether we think it's an appropriate building.
Correct.
Okay,
correct.
So that, I think that's, you know, as long as the by right is in there, I have a problem with that.
Well, and in order to modify that, you have to modify the zone, the planning regulations.
Okay.
I think what you have to do is put it in a different zoning district in which the uses are not permitted by right. And
then is that spot zoning?
Potentially.
Yeah. Okay, and then also, is it possible that during this process we can lower the maximum residential densities from the 50-60 to the 20-35?
Just to be clear, what you're doing tonight is a recommendation to the City Council.
Right, which I'm thankful
for. So you can make whatever recommendation to the City Council you deem appropriate, and you can certainly recommend that it be put in a different height district or a different FAR district or a different residential density district or even a different land use district.
And that wouldn't be spot zoning?
Well, I don't.
You're not making the decision on whether or not you're going to impose that. You're just making a recommendation. The council will be the body that takes the final action and the decision, the determination as to whether or not that is spot zoning would be made at the time that the council makes its decision and based on whatever decision the council actually
makes. And look, I don't want to throw them something that obviously isn't going to fly, but
I think... Well, I just want to note that the height and the FAR, as well as the residential density on the east side of Doyle Street are lower.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm basing my suggestion on.
So that is adjacent.
Right.
So if you were
to that's realistic.
Designate it as those things, it would be like a finger of that designation that just stuck across Doyle Street a little bit. It wouldn't be sitting out there all by itself. It would be attached to another area that had the same designation.
So it's not spot zoning.
I'm not going to say that, but I don't
think it's realistic to put that in there, though.
What about the directly to the south is the office technology designation? Without the planning regulations in front of me, can you kind of give us a quick synopsis of the differences between those two?
Well, actually, directly to the south is the mixed use with non-residential.
OT.
It says OT.
It's office technology. Office technology.
Well, what are you looking at? The
we're looking at the doctor's
exhibit
office.
Exhibit 3. The
but this is the revised.
That's office technology.
Yeah.
We're looking at the parcel across the street.
Are you looking at the land use diagram? Or are you looking at the
map?
The zoning map.
Yeah, zoning map. Exhibit 3.
Okay, that is not a very good print. You can't really see it very well, but the doctor's parcel is actually in a purple designation, which is mixed use with non-residential. The OT is fronting on Hollis Street. And if you know where, that'd be helpful.
You can see it on Exhibit 1 a little better. There's two
Michael's going to put the general plan. This is the general plan map. It's not the zoning map, but it's the same thing. Spur Alley, which runs at a curve there behind, is the dividing line between the two. Mm-hmm. Can you point to where that is, Michael?
I'm sorry. Spur Alley.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right. To the right a little. There. Right there. Yeah. So that curvy line there is Spur Alley. The doctor's parcel is in purple, which is MUN, mixed use non-residential. And then the other to the other side of Spur Alley is OT.
What's the height in the mixed-use non-residential?
Well, the height doesn't go by zoning district. It goes by the height map. Okay.
What's the height?
But the height in that entire area is all 30 by right, 55 with bonus.
And in the medium-density residential is, once again?
Across Doyle Street?
Mm-hmm.
It's 30 feet, period.
So could we perhaps recommend that they put that height limit on it?
Yes, you can.
That would be my recommendation, is to change that to the 2035 density and the height maximum 30.
But leave the FAR at 1.2, 1.6.
Is that possible to put in that kind of size of a building?
Well, you have to provide the parking is existing plus parking.
For right.
Makes no sense at all.
You would think.
I guess you could do stacked parking.
So that would be my personal recommendation in order to support this, because my fear is, luckily, City Council has to make the ultimate decision, so I'm very thankful for that. But I'd like to give them something that is actually viable, and so that would be something I'd want to do, is forward that with those changes. And, you know, because I hate the idea of losing the park altogether.
Yeah, I'd like to save the...
Yeah.
Yeah, the park and the visual continuity between that whole corridor, because that's part of what makes that potentially such a good place, is that there isn't something blocking between those two sites. And I think that it makes sense that the park be on the Hollis side, even though it's a little bit less pedestrian friendly now. It's trying to be made more pedestrian friendly. There's retail restaurant uses on that southwest corner, we hope, and that could be something that would be well used, and there's pedestrian access on both sides of the parcel, but the idea that a building would go there in the future of whatever height is problematic. I think the parking is, you know, it's not in an ideal world, the parking isn't the best use there, but it's there, by, and it's been there, and at least it keeps the open view, and it keeps a sense of openness, even though there's cars parked there. So whatever we can.
I have a lot of comments. I was waiting until we were done asking questions.
Basically, we have to make a recommendation. Do you have a proposed recommendation to make to the City Council?
Well, if you're asking me a question.
Before we get to what Sean was going to say, I just want to clarify what our action truly is tonight, because I'm hearing make recommendations, but I'm reading that we're actually adopting this resolution to amend the general plan and this rezoning.
To recommend
adopting a resolution to recommend those things to the City Council.
Okay, so it's still, we're only recommending, okay.
So, I mean, if you're asking me that question, it making it the medium density residential designation makes me uncomfortable. It doesn't look very good on the map. It's the only time in my life I'm going to get to spot zone anything, so I kind of want to make the recommendation, but do I think it's an appropriate recommendation? No, I don't think I do.
Well, what would be your...
I like the staff recommendation, and I was going to ask. I'm getting a little disjointed because I had some comments I wanted to make, but maybe I did want to ask maybe if the city attorney could give us like a 2.5 minute primer on how kind of zoning private properties, park and open space might affect a regulatory taking.
I'm wondering if you could. Do you have a question about whether or not the zoning, the fact that we're zoning it constitutes a regulatory taking?
Would you have a concern about that?
I mean, that's part of the issue of what spot zoning is supposed to, that's the reason why you don't, or part of the reason why you don't do spot zoning, right, is because that fear that you're basically precluding somebody who would otherwise be able to build in that area because all of the other surrounding area is in the same kind of zoning and or land use designation. You're preventing that person from doing that simply because you don't like a particular project. And that's part of the reason why spot zoning is illegal. So you have to be able to, I mean, the city does change its zoning and its land use designations. That's a very common practice. The you know, what you are trying to avoid is the, you know, the situation where you are spot zoning such that, or where you're changing those designations in a basically an arbitrary manner that isn't consistent with the surrounding land use designations around that particular parcel in question.
Right, but so taking spot zoning out of the equation for a second, we have a parcel which is now which if this map is approved, we would create a we have an existing parcel configuration, but we would create a new parcel configuration, a privately owned and a
Actually, if I can stop you there, you're not actually creating any parcel designations. All you're doing is you're redesignating the zoning and the land use.
The map's not part of our consideration tonight.
The parcel map?
Yeah.
No.
No.
Oh.
No. The parcel map.
Parcel
not.
Maps are approved administratively.
Oh, okay.
All you're being all right. asked, so the only, if I can just pause this here for a second so that I can clarify the action that the commission is being asked to take tonight. The commission is being asked to make recommendations, not final actions. And you're being asked to make recommendations on two issues. One is the general plan designation, land use designation for the subject parcels, and two, the zoning, amending the zoning for those parcels. That's it, a general plan amendment and a zoning amendment. There is, and those are recommendations only, with a final decision going to the City Council.
Okay, so, all right, that's, I understand now. I saw all the parcel map exhibits and I thought that was part of our consideration. So, but at any rate, it doesn't really affect my question, which is, so we have now two will be one, or I guess it's actually been reconfigured as one privately owned parcel, which at some point got rezoned to park and open space.
No, the land swap has not happened yet.
That is just a proposed parcel map.
Part of the reason for the staff recommendation to change the land use designation and the zoning and the general plan maps is to allow for the land swap to happen where the parcel lines will change so that it's consistent with the uses that we're anticipating, i.e. the open space for the park, as was approved by the City Council.
Okay, so maybe I'll frame it this way. So we have a former railroad right-of-way that is partially owned by the city, partially privately owned, anticipating the paper mill project and the park that would be there. It sounds like this City Council at some point rezoned all of that with the new planning regulations to be park and open space. So we're now being asked to recommend a general plan amendment and rezoning to put part of it back into the mixed use with residential zone, general plan designation and corresponding zoning district, a part of it which appropriately reflects the parking lot and the park configuration that were subsequently approved.
So
is that a good synopsis?
So that we can have
right.
the park.
Yes.
And
we won't have the park.
To elaborate a little further, the doctors are requesting basically that the zoning of their property be put back to what it was when they acquired it.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So to me, it seems like the what we did in the planning regulations with putting it in the open space and mixed use was a little premature because we did that before we had an exact configuration of the parcels and the park, and now we're just correcting it to reflect what's actually been approved.
Right.
So I guess since I'm talking, I wanted to say earlier, thank you everybody for coming tonight. I just I get really fired up when I see this many people come to speak on a small project, a small routine project like this, because I've been to many public meetings with more interesting projects and nobody there. So it's really encouraging to see an engaged community.
Any further comments? Haven't heard from you.
Well, I was just going to say, with regard to the recommendations, I think that it would be more appropriate for the residential density to be lower, to be within the 25, the 20 to 35, which I think one of the other commissioners also agreed with. And right now, the maximum building height designation is 30, or is that being considered to change for some reason?
No.
Okay, so staying as is.
Well, 30 by right, 55 with bonus.
55 with bonus. Okay.
I would note that there is no lower height limit by right. There is a height limit of 30 feet that has no possible bonus.
Yeah.
But there is nothing by right lower than 30 feet.
Okay.
So if you made it medium density residential, which is catty corner from this parcel, that would be a 30-foot height limit, is that right?
No. The height map and the zoning map are different maps.
So we could say 30 feet, no bonus?
You could. That's what's across Doyle Street.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I also just want to note that the general plan amendment that we're being asked to make is to remove the conceptual green circle and to actually locate that park.
Correct.
So I think we're getting a little mixed up with the rezone, but the general plan amendment is pretty simple. And we're actually, in my mind, we're sort of bringing the zoning into more conformance with the general plan. Because right now the general plan designation for the entire block is mixed use with residential, with a conceptual park location shown on there. So we're leaving some of that site as mixed use with residential, and we would be recommending a change to actually locate the park where it's actually going to be, and then to likewise make the zoning consistent with that change. So with those comments, I would like to make a motion to make a recommendation to the City Council, to approve a general plan amendment and to add a maximum residential density designation of 50/60 units per acre and to rezone the proposed Payne and Rehabilitation Consultants Management Group parking lot parcel at the northwest corner of the Stamford Avenue and Doyle Street from PO Park and Open Space to MUR mixed use with residential and redesignate the surrounding city property from mixed use with residential to park and open space on the general plan land use diagram. I know that's a mouthful.
Basically the staff recommendation.
Staff recommendation.
With height limit or without height?
Well, I'm not clear with those designations what limits we can put on.
Well, we can recommend anything we want to the City Council.
Right, but I mean, I'm comfortable with these particular designations. I'm not really looking at it from a height standpoint. I'm looking at it from a land use standpoint. So, and I'm looking at it from the standpoint of the map, where it's what we have existing, and so I think it makes the most sense to keep it and to configure the park as it's actually going to be configured.
Oh, is that a motion?
That is a motion.
Yes, that was a motion.
Do we have a second? I'll second it. Can we have a vote?
All right. On the motion for the staff recommendation, Commissioner Donaldson?
No.
Commissioner Gunkel is recused. Commissioner Keller?
I'm going to abstain.
Commissioner Coomerly?
No.
Commissioner Tan?
No.
Vice Chair Moss?
Aye.
Chair Cardoza?
Aye.
Two ayes, three noes, one abstention. The motion fails.
Can I make a secondary motion?
And make a motion.
I'd like to make the staff recommendation motion, but making the changes that the zoning be for medium density for 20 to 35.
Wait, the zoning be RM?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that correct?
RM.
Yeah, medium res.
Stephen, what did you want again?
Well, I'd like to make it like the property kitty corner across the street. So I'd like to be that it's consistent with the neighborhood.
All right. Well, south. So, yeah. Okay.
With the residential being 20 to up to 35, and set a maximum height limit to 30 feet with no bonus.
So RM.
But we're not really setting the height limit, right? We're just establishing a...
I'm setting this height limit.
Is the height limit.
Yeah. No, the height limit is 30-55.
30-55.
He's suggesting a change to the height map also.
Correct.
To change it from 30-55 to 30, no bonus.
Correct.
So we can... I guess so that's what I don't understand. So we can change the heights independent of the zoning districts?
There's correct.
Like, yes.
They're different
maps.
Yeah, they don't...
We have a base map, base like zone map. We have an overlay zone map. We have a height map, a residential density map.
We have a FAR.
And a FAR map. Yeah. By the way, one thing just to clarify, I mean, this really won't affect what you're doing tonight, but the height, FAR, and residential density maps are all part of the general plan. Mm-hmm. So when you change those maps, you're doing a general plan amendment. Mm-hmm. The base zone is, and the overlay zones are what are part of the zoning. So you'll notice that in our report and our resolution for you, we have the change to the residential density. That's a general plan amendment. So changing the height is a general plan amendment. That's okay. I just want to clarify that.
Okay.
Okay. So I will maybe, I don't know. I'm just going to say this. I don't know if this is going to end up in a second of your motion or not, but I would support a motion that would... we can establish whatever heights we want. I'll support whatever you guys want to go with, but if the property stays in the mixed use with the residential zoning district, I would support that motion.
And do we have such a district that would be mixed use residential that's 20 to 35 units? No.
Once again, the base zone, the residential density map, the height map, they're all different maps. The residential density does not go with the base zone. You can pick whatever base zone you want, and you can pick whatever residential density you want because they're on different maps.
They're independent.
So, they're independent. So you could have the MUR zoning district, as Commissioner Moss is suggesting, and you could have the 20/35 residential density as you're suggesting, because that's a different map.
And a 30-foot height limit.
And the 30-foot height limit.
Okay, so that would be my motion.
So I haven't heard you mention FAR, so you
I think
happy
you
with the FAR as
FAR
it is?
FAR be the same.
One yeah. point. Same as it is now?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll second that.
So you're saying MUR now? MUR zone?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
But the height, it says base with bonus is 20-35.
That's residential density.
No, that's the density.
Yeah, okay. Sorry.
I would support that as well.
Was that a second
yeah,
by
that
Commissioner
was a second.
Tan?
Commissioner
Thank
Tan seconded.
Thank you.
So, to clarify, it would be basically the staff recommendation for the base zone, which is MUR, and then it would be modifying the residential density map to 20-35 instead of whatever it was that we
50
suggested.
50-60.
And then also modifying the height map from 30-55 to 30, no okay. bonus. No change to the FAR map.
Correct.
And then our recommended change to the general plan land use map, I assume, would be what you're saying, which would be the park area becomes open space.
Correct. And we Doctor's eliminate
Doctor's parcel remains MUR, and we eliminate the green circle.
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm.
That's all. Okay. That's
it. And do you agree with that, Carrie?
Yes. I still second.
So we have a motion and a second. We have a
ready to vote? Commissioner Donaldson?
I'm still going to vote no because I think that a building there would be a mistake.
Commissioner Gunkel is recused. Commissioner Keller?
Aye.
Commissioner Coomerly?
No.
Commissioner Tan?
Aye.
Vice Chair Moss?
No.
Chair Cardoza?
Aye.
Three ayes, three noes. The motion fails.
So we make no recommendation.
We're not making a recommendation tonight.
I don't see that it's in the best public interest to lose that open space either. So that's why I voted no.
Well, the alternatives we have are we leave the parking as it is now, and we don't have a nice park.
Well, unless we'll make a different park.
They still have that zoning.
Is that the... I'm surprised that this is the issue because it's we don't have the open space in the general plan designations now, so we're making a recommendation. We're not even making a recommendation to create it.
I just did. You said no. Although you said you would support it.
There's a conceptual open space.
Yeah, and I think what Charlie was saying earlier too was that the general plan is general and that these other maps are more specific.
Well, the zoning map specific than the general plan, yes.
On
that motion, you're deadlocked.
It's the intent that be an open corridor, and that's the point that we're making, that I'm making here, and that a parking lot at least is an open visual corridor. It is private property. It was always a parking lot, and it can always be a parking lot, but that's sort of where I'm standing.
Confused, Charlie. What happens if there's no agreement with the current owner of the parking lots and the city? Do those existing parking lots have the mixed-use residential zoning on them?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So they stay?
No. They have mixed use with residential general plan land use designation. They have open space zoning.
Point of order. How does a motion to reconsider work? Who can make a motion to reconsider? Oh, yeah, that's true. We could make the same. I guess we could make the same motion again.
Make a motion.
Yeah.
Are you changing your mind?
And move to reconsider?
Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay, the city attorney advises that if you voted no, you can move to reconsider.
Okay.
Or you can always
make the motion
make
again.
A new motion.
Yeah. I'll just make a motion to reconsider.
You need
a second?
Okay,
second.
Commissioner Tan. Okay, reconsider.
Then you have to have a motion.
Yes, thank you. So, Commissioner Moss made a motion to reconsider, seconded by Commissioner Tan. We have to vote on that.
And what are we reconsidering? My motion? My original
motion? I believe so.
Okay.
Is that right? Yes.
Yes.
I believe so. Okay. Are you ready to vote on whether to reconsider?
Yes.
On whether to reconsider, Commissioner Donaldson?
Aye.
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Keller?
Aye.
Commissioner Tan?
Aye.
Oh, I'm sorry, Commissioner Coomerly?
Aye.
Tan. And Vice Chair Moss?
Aye.
And Chair Cardoza.
Aye.
Wait. Six ayes. You may reconsider that motion.
So
I'd like to make the motion again.
You don't need to because you already did. You're just reconsidering the vote on it. So are you ready to vote on the motion again?
Yes.
Aye.
No. All right. Commissioner Donaldson.
I'm still no for the same reason that I don't think it a building there will create an enhanced and connected open space network. So,
Commissioner Keller?
Aye.
Commissioner Coomerly?
No.
Commissioner Tan?
Aye.
A Vice Chair Moss?
Aye, because the I regret maybe there were some missed opportunities there, but the City Council has approved the design of this park, and I will vote aye on the recommendations to bring the general plan and the zoning into conformance with it.
And Chair Cardoza?
Aye, and I'm voting for it because I think the modifications we've made to the land use on the new parking lot are such that it will probably never be built on.
But we didn't.
All right, we have four ayes and two noes, so that motion is approved, and we will forward that to the City Council with your recommendation.
Can we take a restroom break, please?
You want to take a break?
Yes.